Greetings, I'm Anthony L. Elmore, President and Founder of the Proud Black Buddhist World Association. We at the Proud Black Buddhist World Association are the Black Buddhist voice in America. Let me be clear, we are a cultural Black Buddhist organization and not a racial Buddhist organization. We are like a Black radio station or a Black cultural event like Kwanzaa or Black History Month, where we acknowledge the culture and contributions of Black people and America. Let me cite an example for you. Just a few months ago, last year, at the Mall of Washington, a new building premiered called the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History and Culture. This museum is more than just an African American story, but this museum is an American story. Just like the Museum of African American History, we are the African American or the Black Buddhist voice in America. Now, in the world of the Buddhist religion, in the first century AD, a white Kushan king by the name of Kanishka and a man who was a former Brahmin scholar by the name of Ashvaghosha created a new Buddhism in the world over 600 years after the death of the Buddha Shakyamuni. King Kanishka and Ashvaghosha were successful in separating the religion of Buddhism based on race, culture, and language. This is what happened. They changed the Buddha from black to white. Please view the Gandhara images. They also changed the language of Buddhism to a new language where it is conclusive based on archaeological evidence of an icon called the Rudra Dhanam. This is the earliest evidence of the new language only found in the AD. This new language was called Sanskrit. The language of Sanskrit is the language of the Hindu Brahmin. Now, this new religion spread throughout Asia and was called Mahayana Buddhism. Mahayana Buddhism is the time in Buddhist history where Buddhism was separated based on race, culture, and language. Now, let me explain. The culture of Mahayana Buddhism, it was to rewrite the over 600-year Buddhist history and write Black people out of the Buddhist history. Now, let me cite an example. The Kingdom of Magadha, where the Buddha was born, was started by Black people who were called Naga. Magadha was founded by a man by the name of Sisu Naga. Now, about 200 years after the death of Sisu Naga, we read about King Bimbisara, who was a contemporary of the Buddha Shakyamuni. Shakyamuni emerged in Magadha, which is proven was an all-black kingdom, and they spoke the language of Parsi. Now, for over 2,000 years, Mahayana Buddhism via a Sanskrit language has been a culture, whereas all Black Buddhist history, culture, and language has been written out of the Buddhist history and culture. In 2017, whites and Asians have one thing to say about the rewrite of history. They say, what difference does it make whether the Buddha was black or white? The question asked to what the difference does it make whether the Buddha was black or white leads us to the topic of our Buddhist lecture today. Our lecture today is called Movie Hidden Figures, a Black Buddhist Lecture. On February 20th, 1962, America's first astronaut, John Glenn, was the first American to orbit the Earth. February is also the time when Nichiren Buddhism was born, and it's Black History Month in America. Now, also on February 20th, 1962, we African Americans made history because three black women helped NASA to get John Glenn in America into our space program. Now, what our Buddhist lecture is about, it's about the movie Hidden Figures, because the story of black people being involved in NASA's first successful launch, a man who travels around the earth, black people were involved. Now, let me give you a synopsis of the movie. The film recounts the story of three African-American women who worked in professional positions at NASA and helped the United States advance during the space race. Mathematician Katherine Johnson and her two colleagues, Dorothy Vaughn and Mary Jackson, worked in the segregated West Area Computer Division of Langley Research Center in Hampton, Virginia. Using these calculations, NASA supported John Glenn in becoming the first American astronaut to make a complete orbit of Earth. Unquote. Now, this is the point. We at the proud Black Buddhist World Association make, as white people say, what difference that it makes that 55 years ago, three black women worked as mathematicians to help America not only to get into space. These black women helped America to put a man on the moon. The other question that you may ask is, what does three black women helping to get America into space race have to do with the Buddhist religion? See, let me explain to you about the Buddhist religion. We at the Proud Black Buddhist World Association practice the Buddhist teachings as taught by the 13th century Japanese Buddhist sage Nichiren Shonin. It is Nichiren Shonin who teaches us that we must follow only the Lotus Sutra as supreme. You see, the way we learn about Buddhist teachings of Shakyamuni Buddha is via the teachings of Nichiren Shonin in a work called The Gosho. Now, The Gosho is a compilation of letters that Nichiren Shonin taught to teach his disciples about Shakyamuni Buddha's teachings. There is a Gosho called The Gift of Rites that segue into how Buddhism explained the movie Hidden Figures. Now, this is what The Gift of Rites reads. Quote, "The true path lies in affairs of this world. The Golden Light Sutra states, quote, to have a profound knowledge of this world is itself Buddhism. It goes on further. The Nirvana Sutra states, quote, all of the non-Buddhist scriptures and writings in society are themselves Buddhist teachings and not non-Buddhist teachings. You see, ladies and gentlemen, what they call Buddhism, Buddhism encompasses all the teachings of the universe. Now, first things first, the Gosho reads, quote, number one, the true path lies in affairs of this world. Now, let us not get true Buddhism mixed up with other religions. See, as the Gosho reads, the true path lies in affairs of this world. We can talk all day about God, Jesus, Muhammad, or whatever you want to talk about in religion. Now, when it comes to true Buddhism, the true path lies in affairs of this world. Now, in regards to the movie Hidden Figures, the movie opened Christmas Day, December 25th, 2016. However, the wide release of the movie happened on January the 6th, 2017, and this black movie was the number one movie in America, beating out Star Wars Rogue. Now, let us get back to the Ghost Show, The Gift of Rice, that further reads, quote, the Golden Light Sutra states, quote, to have a profound knowledge of this world is itself Buddhism. The Nirvana Sutra states, all of the non-Buddhist scriptures and writings in society are themselves Buddhist teachings and not non-Buddhist teachings. Now, what is the point here? The point here is that only the Lotus Sutra, the highest of the Buddha's teachings, is the only teaching that delineates true Buddhism from other religions like Christianity, Judaism, Islam, and other forms of Buddhism, including Nichiren Buddhism, as taught by the Japanese sects like the SGI, Nichiren Shoshu, and Nichiren Shu. See, the Gold Show, The Gift of Rice, further reads, quote, when the great teacher Milo compared these passages with the one from the sixth volume of the Lotus Sutra that reads, quote, no worldly affairs of life or work are ever contrary to the true reality. He revealed their meanings and pointed out that although the first two sutras are profound, since their meaning is still shallow and fails to approach that of the Lotus Sutra, they relate to secular matters in terms of Buddhism, whereas the Lotus Sutra explains that in the end, secular matters are the entirety of Buddhism. Now, what is the point here? The point is based on the Lotus Sutra, what the Asians teach us and call it Buddhism is not Buddhism at all. See, the Gosho says that the great Buddhist teacher Milo compared these passages with the one from the sixth volume of the Lotus Sutra that reads, quote, no worldly affairs of life or work are ever contrary to the true reality. He revealed their meanings and pointed out that although the first two sutras are profound, since their meaning is still shallow and fails to approach that of the Lotus Sutra, they relate to secular matters in terms of Buddhism, whereas the Lotus Sutra explains that in the end, secular matters are the entirety of Buddhism. You see, ladies and gentlemen, the movie Hidden Figures is a Buddhist meeting. Now, this is what you find in all world religions, including Buddhist teachings other than the Lotus Sutra. See, all other religions, they relate to secular matters in terms of religion, whereas the Lotus Sutra explains that secular matters is the entirety of Buddhism. Now, let me explain this concept in terms of Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. These religions view phenomena in terms of religion. One example is in the religions, and what is sacred in the religions are their holy book, what they consider the absolute word of God. The books are the Torah in Judaism, and Christianity, we got the Bible, and Islam, we got the Quran. The Gosha again read, quote, they relate to secular matters in terms of Buddhism, whereas the Lotus Sutra explains that in the end, secular matters are the entirety of Buddhism. See, in common sense, practical terms, of all religions except the Lotus Sutra, they relate to secular matters or the world in terms of religion, whereas the Lotus Sutra explains that all phenomena and what is known as religion is the same. See, let me give you a real life example. When I joined Buddhism of the Buddhist faith in 1970, I practiced a form of religion, Buddhist religion called Zen. I practiced Zen meditation, and I called myself a Buddhist. We would sit in a meditation position and chant, and I was studying old Japanese Shotokan karate, which was based on Zen Buddhism, and we would sit there and chant, karate, mind, body, and spirit. What I learned was mind-body exercises. I learned and practiced Zen Buddhism. See, Nichiren Shonin called Zen Buddhism demonic. Now, the Gosho, the Dhammoku of the Lotus Sutra reads, quote, Tentai says the Ichikans, or persons of incorrigible disbelief, nevertheless have minds, and so it is still possible for them to attain Buddhahood. But persons of the two vehicles have annihilated consciousness and therefore cannot arouse the mind that aspires enlightenment. And yet the Lotus Sutra can cure them, which is why it is called myo, or wonderful. See, Milo says, quote, the reason that other sutras are called great, but not myo is simple. It's simply that it is easy to cure those who have a mind, but difficult to cure those without a mind. Because it, the Lotus Sutra, can cure what is thought to be incurable, it is called myo, or wonderful. Now, let me break this down for you. In my Zen Buddhist practice, man, we had to break our knuckles on a concrete wall. And we trained our bodies to, we trained our minds to annihilate our consciousness. And I could sit out and I could go below freezing weather, and we could meditate in icy waters. We would walk around barefoot. I was into this Zen Buddhism, but what I learned was what I was calling Buddhism was annihilated consciousness. When you look around the world of Buddhism and you see Asian men meditating, they call this Buddhism, but this is only annihilated consciousness. What you have is an illusion that via meditation you are supposed to reach this enlightened state of consciousness. There is no such thing outside of your everyday life. Now, let me get back to our topic of our Buddhist lecture, movie, Hidden Figures, a Black Buddhist Lecture. Imagine this movie opened January 6, 2017. It became the number one movie in America that would gross about $23 million. Why is it that this story of three black women working for NASA in 1962 is so important, or why is there so much interest? We can say that black lives matter. Let me be clear. If black lives did not matter, this movie would not be the number one movie in America. Now, let me get back to the Ghost Show, The Gift of Rice, that reads, quote, they relate to secular matters in terms of Buddhism, whereas the Lotus Sutra explains that in the end, secular matters are the entirety of Buddhism. See, the question is, they, or those who relate to secular matters in terms of Buddhism, these are religious people. In the world of Nichiren Buddhism, meaning the SGI, Nichiren Shoshu, and Nichiren Shu, these Japanese are not going to relate or teach Buddhism in relationship to secular matters. They are not going to include the story of three black women in 1962 who played a part in NASA helping not only John Glenn's first ride around the world, but we black people played a role in getting the first man on the moon. Now, let me bring this lecture to the real world. In 1974, I left Zen Buddhism and I joined a Japanese Buddhist sect called NSA or Nichiren Shoshu of America. I want you to see a scene from my 1988 movie called A Contemporary Gladiator. I left Zen Buddhism and I started to chant Nam Myoho Renge Kyo. I changed my views of society in 1974. I was 21 years old. I got away from Zen Buddhism. While I was studying karate and Zen Buddhism, I changed my views of society, and the Buddhist religion or the Nichiren teachings helped me to get back in society. And I made a vow that I would one day become the world heavyweight karate champion, bringing happiness to myself and helping to make the world a better place. Let's look at a scene from my 1988 movie called The Contemporary Gladiator, where I make a commitment to become the world karate kickboxing champion.
Those who were late for the meeting, we next have Anthony Elmore to give an experience. Yay!
Good evening! Good evening! Since I've joined NSA, I have changed my views of society, and I have rekindled my desire to attain the American dream. For many years, I've practiced karate. About 3 years ago, a new sport was born in America called karate kickboxing, and I have made the determination to one day become the world karate kickboxing champion, therefore creating happiness for myself and at the same time bringing happiness to others. Thank you very much. Now, you saw a scene from my 1988 movie where I make the commitment to become the world karate kickboxing champion. Please understand that I live Buddhism with my life. I live Buddhism with my heart, soul, and my entire being. See, this lecture, movie, Hidden Figures, a Black Buddhist Lecture, is a call from the universe to help us Black Buddhists. The most important aspect of the movie is the shock that Black people get when they find out that not only were Black people a part of America's first flight around the world, it was a Black woman by the name of Katherine Johnson who did the mathematics and played a key role in America's NASA's first flight. Another thing I want you to understand, as Black people, you should be outraged.
What stuck out to me was the fact that I didn't know the story, that I didn't know these incredible women, and it bothered me. And then I was honored. I was really, really honored that this project had come to me. And then it was a range of emotions. And then there was fear because I'm not mathematically and scientifically wired. And so that scared me, but I felt a great, I can't say a pressure, but I felt that I had to do it. Like, I felt like I couldn't say no.
You know what we're doing here? We're putting a human on top of a missile, shooting him into space, and it's never been done before. I need a mathematician that can look beyond the numbers. Math that doesn't yet exist. Before the Russians plant a flag on the damn moon.
You have someone? Running toward our plans. Catherine's the gal for that. She can handle any numbers you put in front of her.
Don't embarrass me.
This wasn't emptied last night.
I'm sorry, I'm not the...
It was the 60s. Everything was segregated. There was racism, no doubt. And she was a woman. But she didn't let any of that hold her back. It was like she had every obstacle stacked against her, and nothing could stop her. That was her gift. That was to be her legacy. You know when they say God, if he has something for you, no man can take it from you. Jim Crow couldn't take it from her. Segregation, racism could not take her journey away. Because here we are in 2016, and we're doing their story.
Egypt. Please understand that at the time of this lecture, a black man by the name of Major General Charles Frank Bolden Jr. is the head of NASA. And he said this on January the 10th, 2017. Quote, going to space might have not been possible without the help of the three black women who served as the brains behind one of the greatest operations in NASA history, unquote. See, at the time of this lecture, we have a black president of the United States of America, and we have a black man who heads NASA. In the world of Buddhism, there is not a black man who runs nothing. Black Buddhists should be outraged that in our entire world, black people have no prominent role in Buddhism. The reason that black people do not have a prominent role in Buddhism is because Japanese and Asian masters promote a system of racism in Buddhism that is just as bad as Joe Sixpack or what Donald Trump wants to promote in America. The reason that Buddhism is not a part of our black culture, history, and language is because we do not have black Buddhist voices until we at the Proud Black Buddhists emerge. We don't have a black Buddhist voice. Now, the Gold Show, the true aspect of all phenomena reads, quote, the expedient means chapter of the first volume of the Lotus Sutra states, quote, the true aspect of all phenomena can only be understood and shared between Buddhas. This reality consists of appearance, nature, and their consistency from beginning to the end. What does this passage mean? Unquote. You see, in regards to the movie Hidden Figures, the Lotus Sutra, or rather the expedient means chapter of the Lotus Sutra states, quote, the true aspect of all phenomena can only be understood and shared between Buddhas. This reality consists of appearance, nature, and their consistency from beginning to the end. Please understand that the true aspect of all phenomena can only be understood and shared between Buddhas. Now, those who are not Buddhas look at phenomena or explain it as the work of nature or as the work of God. Let me explain from the standpoint of Nichiren Buddhism. There are Nichiren Buddhist sects like the SGI, Nichiren Shoshu, and Nichiren Shu. In the case of the SGI, they have a Buddhist master they call Sensei, whose name is Daisaku Keda. Daisaku Keda is revered by SGI members as an almost demigod or a living Buddha. They have a hero worship song that SGI members sing called Sensei. You join hands together and you praise this Japanese leader. You have black people singing a song about this Japanese leader, and they don't even sing a song about Dr. Martin Luther King. This weekend is MLK weekend in America, and they're not celebrating Dr. Martin Luther King, who helped get the Civil Rights Act of 1964 passed that eliminated legal separation in America. Now, there is a set, a Nichiren set that I practiced with for 40 years called Nichiren Shoshu. They have a Buddhist priest system, whereas you are expected to faithfully follow these priests, and you have a head priest like a living Buddha who is supposed to be the absolute inheritor of the Buddhist law. You worship a piece of camphor wood called the Dago Hunsen as your ultimate object of worship. Now, this is what Nichiren Shoshu teach. And you are supposed to worship this piece of camphor wood as the absolute law of the universe. There is no such thing as a one absolute law of the universe. Nothing like that could be possible given to one single person. That is a lie. That is fraud. Now, there is a Japanese Nichiren Buddhist sect called Nichiren Shu. I was looking to join Nichiren Shu under the black female Nichiren Shu priest, Muke Shonin. And when I asked the Nichiren Shu heads about their relationship or policy to black people, I was told that I was no longer welcome at Nichiren Shu meetings. Now, let us get back to our Black Buddhist Lecture movie, Hidden Figures, a Black Buddhist Lecture. The gift of rice reads, quote, they relate to secular matters in terms of Buddhism, whereas the Lotus Sutra explains that in the end, secular matters are the entirety of Buddhism. See, it is only the Lotus Sutra that explains that secular matters are the entirety of Buddhism. You see, since secular matters are the entirety of Buddhism, the movie Hidden Figures is Buddhism. Now, the Expedia means chop, the Lotus Sutra again reads, quote, the true aspect of all phenomena can only be understood and shared between Buddhas. This reality consists of appearance, nature, and their consistency from beginning to end. Now, let me put this in everyday terms for you. How in the hell, in 1962, that John Glenn became the first American to orbit the Earth, and we had three black women who were not only a part of this success, if perhaps not for these black women, NASA may not be as successful as it is today. We can go to the movie theater and watch the movie like everyone else. We in this lecture present the movie from a Buddhist aspect. Let me be clear. We present this movie, Hidden Figures, from the standpoint of a black Buddhist and the Lotus Sutra. You see, for those of you who do not have an idea about Buddhism and the Lotus Sutra and black people practicing Buddhism, I want you to refer you to Tina Turner. Please understand that Tina Turner has never put an Asian in her shadow in regards to Buddhism. In regards to the Lotus Sutra, Tina approached the Buddhist faith only from her life and her personal experience. In regards to the Lotus Sutra, what the practice does is that it helps you to think correctly. Now, listen to me very closely. The purpose of chanting and the purpose of practicing Buddhism is to help you think correctly. Now, we got these Japanese have you thinking that if you get around with these priests or you get with this organization, that organization, you are going to become enlightened. The purpose of chanting is to help you think correctly. Now, what I want you to do, thinking correctly is the essence of the Lotus Sutra. Now, I want you to, first of all, listen to Tina Turner explain that the purpose of Buddhism is to help you think correctly. Now, what Tina Turner and I both was a member of NSA / SGI. We both left these organizations and we have no association with these Japanese sets. They still parade around the fact saying that Tina Turner is a part of their set. Tina Turner has nothing to do with no Japanese or no Asian Buddhist. She never put them into her shadow. Listen to Tina Turner explain to you that the purpose of the Buddhist teachings is to help you think correctly. Let's listen to Tina Turner.
What the practice does, it helps you to feel better, helps you to think different. If you think different, you think correctly. I would say it helps you to think correctly. So that means you can help yourself get the things you want. Some people say, I was told that I could get things, whether it's a car or a house, which some people need help in that way. Well, of course, because you change an old style of thinking, which is not very smart, that blocks you from getting where you want to get. But once you start putting words in, the same words, it's like typing in good thoughts. Mm. You type it in and you get a whole rollout of good thoughts. Your brain is thinking good thoughts. Your mind is constantly rolling and saying good things. So you think differently, which helps you to get to where you want to get your car, your house, and to feel good. It's really very important what you say, what you think, how often you say it.
Well, to use the metaphor of a computer, garbage in, garbage out.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yes.
You heard Tina Turner say the purpose of the Buddhist teachings is to help you think correctly. Now, the point of this lecture is to explain Buddhism using the movie Hidden Figures to explain the profound teachings of Buddhism. Again, the Expedient Means chapter of the Lotus Sutra again reads, quote, the true aspect of all phenomena can only be understood and shared between Buddhas. This reality consists of the appearance, the nature, and all of the ten aspects that are consistent from beginning to end. See, we move back to the point of Tina Turner. We chant Namu Myoharinge Kyo to awaken our Buddha nature, or in common sense terms, we learn to think correctly. When a common person look at the movie Hidden Figures, they see Taraja P. Henson as Katherine Johnson, mathematician, Octavia Spencer as Dorothy Vaughn, mathematician, and later head or personnel, and Janet Morey as Mary Jackson, engineer, and Kevin Costner as Al Harrison. Now, we who practice Buddhism, or what we call Buddhism, place the Lotus Sutra as the ultimate teachings of the Buddha Shakyamuni. The essence of the Lotus Sutra is the title. Now, the title of the Lotus Sutra is Myoharinge Kyo. See, we give reverence to the Lotus Sutra. Let me explain how we give reverence to the Lotus Sutra. See, we give reverence to the Lotus Sutra by devoting our lives to the Lotus Sutra. See, the word Namu, this word means reverence or devotion. Now, Psalm says Nam. Now, Nam or Namu means to awaken. Psalm said devotion. We put our faith in the Lotus Sutra, or we awaken or devote or give reverence to the Lotus Sutra by reciting the title, which is Myoharinge Kyo. Our goal is to learn to think correctly. Those of us who are religious or who believe in God or gods call God many things. When I was a youth, we used to say, God is a mystery. The Lotus Sutra, we said the same thing. We only use the word myo. See, the word myo means many things. One of the meanings is unfathomable. It also means incomprehensible. When we say myo, we mean mystic or mysterious. Another word or meaning for myo is to open. If you wish to bring God into your life, you must open. Another name for myo is cause. We say that the cause of everything is God, or myo is a cause. Now, one of the most important meanings of the word myo is correct. Many of us refer to God as truth. No matter how anyone describes the concept of God, this concept will always equal myo, or God is truth. Now, let us refer to the title of our lecture, Movie Hidden Figures, a Black Buddhist Lecture. This movie, Hidden Figures, is also a manifestation of myo, or a cause. Now, in regards to the Lotus Sutra, or the title of the Lotus Sutra, the Lotus Sutra explains all life's phenomena as whole. See, the word whole means manifestations. All phenomena or happenings explained as whole or in effect. Every happening or manifestation in our universe is whole or in effect. Everything happening in our universe is result of myo, which is a cause. We call myo. In effect is whole or a manifestation of a law. Now, let us get back to the title of our lecture, Movie Hidden Figures, a Black Buddhist Lecture. We call our lecture Myoho, or Mystic Law. The Lotus Sutra explains that all phenomena are whole or law manifests 3,000 realms in a mutually inclusive relationship of all life and phenomena. Now, in regards to the mutually inclusive relationship to all life and phenomena in our universe, this is explained by the Lotus Sutra and Namu Myoho-Renge-Kyo. Now, the way this is explained is by the word ho. The word ho and the word Ichinin Sanzan, or the realm of 3,000 worlds in a mutually inclusive relationship, that is ho, or Ichinin Sanzan, means the same identical thing. See, Ichinin Sanzan is a Japanese word, which literally, Ichinin Sanzan can be translated as moment of existence and 3,000 aspects. See, each moment of existence of all living beings, Ichinin, is endowed with all 3,000 realms of phenomena. Sanzan. Ichin means a moment of life. Ichin means one and signifies the one ultimate truth or the middle way of the Dharma nature. A single moment of existence encompasses all the elements that forms a common mortal's life, such as body and mind, and cause and effect. Now, the term refers to all forms of existence. For example, Sanzan includes every single phenomenon in the entire universe. This doctrine teaches that even the smallest bit of life possessed by any single entity is actually endowed with all phenomena of the 3,000 different realms. Now, let us put this in common terms in relationship to our lecture, Movie Hidden Figures, a Black Buddhist Lecture. You see, on February 20th, 1962, American astronaut John Glenn was the first American to orbit the Earth. I remember so well in that I was 9 years old at Don Avenue Elementary School. I was in the third grade. This was a big thing for us youth in school and in America. We had no idea of the concept of black or white or discrimination. We lived in an all-black neighborhood. We had all-black teachers. And a Chinese man owned the neighborhood store, and all white people owned the businesses. White insurance men would come to our homes to collect money. When you look at the movie Hidden Figures or the story, we had no idea that black or African-American women were part of the NASA space program. Now, we covered the words Namu Myoho. Now, let us understand the words Rin and Gay. See, the word Rin and Gay, these words represent the symbol. See, the symbol of Rin is lotus flower. See, a lotus flower has the flower in the seed. Now, this is a symbol which means the oneness of the law of cause and effect. See, when we see cause and effect, we look at it through the dimension of space and time, the past, the present, and the future. See, in the dimension of the universe, the past, the present, and future exist in a singularly momentary state of existence, and all phenomena manifest at a single moment. However, the reason that you don't see the law working is because of the dimension of time and space. Now, when you look at the movie Hidden Figures or the story, we had no idea that black people was involved or black women was involved in this. Now, we covered the words Namu and Myoho, and we're now telling you about Rin and Gay. Now, let us move to February 20th, 1962, whereas American astronaut John Glenn became the first American astronaut to orbit the Earth. That was Myoho or Myoho Ringe. See, in the Go Show, the Daimoku of the Lotus Sutra, this explains the meaning of Kyo. Now, again, it's called the Daimoku of the Lotus Sutra, and it reads, quote, within this single character, Kyo, are contained all the sutras in the worlds throughout the 10 directions. It is like a wish-granting jewel that contains within it all manners of treasures or the vastness of space that encompasses all phenomena. And because this single character, Kyo, of Myoho Ringe Kyo, is the supreme achievement of the Buddha's lifetime of teachings, the other four characters, Myoho Ringe, likewise surpass all the 80,000 doctrines that the Buddha taught. Unquote. You see, you may not understand the meaning of Kyo or Sutra or how Buddhist teachings is related to the movie Hidden Figures. However, Variety magazine writes, quote, Hidden Figures soars again while Ben Affleck's Life by Night monster truck tanks. See, Hidden Figures is overperforming for the second weekend in a row as it is focused to finish the MLK weekend with 20 million at 3,200 movie sites. See, Hidden Figures topped Disney's Lucasfilm Rogue, won the Star Wars Story last weekend by about $700,000 with 22.8 million at 2,474 sites. Then the studio added 800 screens for this weekend. In other words, they had no idea the movie was going to do what it did. It overperformed. It shocked them. You see, the Go Show or writings of Nichiren Shonen, there's a Go Show called The True aspect of all phenomena, which we've quoted several times. See, the expedient means chart, the Lotus Sutra states that the true aspect of all phenomena can only be understood and shared between Buddhas. This reality consists of the appearance, the nature, and the entity. These are the 10 aspects, rather, and they are consistent from beginning to end. You see, this explains how the movie Hidden Figures is a Buddhist movie. You see, the Lotus Sutra explains that the reality or truth of all phenomena consists of 10 aspects. Now, these are the 10 aspects. All phenomena has what? An appearance, number one, a nature, number two, an entity, number three, a power, number four, an influence, number five, an inherent cause, number six, a relationship, number seven, a latent effect, number eight, a manifest effect, number nine, and a consistency of beginning to the end, 10. These are the 10 aspects. See, those of you, Black people, who are listening to this lecture, I have to talk Black to Black people. See, if you are white, you may not understand, but this is a cultural thing. You see, on February the 20th, 1962, when John Glenn orbited the Earth, America was no place for no nigga. See, in 1962 in Memphis, Tennessee, we had many men in our neighborhood who made their livings driving a cotton field bus. You would be hard pressed in Memphis, Tennessee in 1962 to find any African American or Black person who had a cotton picking age, who had never in their life picked cotton. Even though we lived in the city, during the fall and during the plant time, we go out there and chop cotton, and during the harvest time, we go out there and pick cotton, and you could not find a Black person who had never picked cotton. The only reason that I have never picked cotton in my life, because my brothers would not let me go to the cotton field. They said, no, we're not going to let you go to the cotton field. And I wanted to go make that $1.25 a day chopping cotton or make some money picking cotton. But I was only, 9 years old in 1962, and they wouldn't let me go. But there were other young people who were my age who was out there chopping and picking cotton. Now, the only reason that Katherine Johnson and Black people worked in NASA is because NASA needed mathematicians. And even then, Blacks were treated like niggers. Let me take you to the real deal. In 2017, there is not a white person or an Asian person who want to tell a Black story better or more anxiously than Black people want to tell a Black story. See, in regards to the Buddhist religion, it's going to take Black Buddhists to teach other Blacks Buddhism. That is because, and listen to me very closely and clearly, Asians are no better than Joe Sixpack when it comes to teaching Black people Buddhism, because when you look around and you look at the story, most Asians have extricated all Black Buddhist history, culture, and language from the Buddhist teachings. And all you are going to be in the Buddhist religion, as far as an Asian is concerned, you are only going to be a subordinate nigger or subordinate negro. Now, we Buddhists who practice and understand the Lotus Sutra understand phenomena in regards to true Buddhism or cause and effect. See, in regards to the movie Hidden Figures, one of the causes of the movie happened in 1969 when a black woman by the name of Margaret Lee, I assume. Now, what is clear is the fact that this woman's name is Margaret Lee Shetterly. Her married name is Shetterly. Now, she is the writer of the book Hidden Figures. Now, this is what she writes. Quote, "For me growing up in Hampton, Virginia, the face of science was brown like mine. My dad was a NASA lifer, a career Langley Research Center scientist who became an internationally respected climate expert. Five of my father's seven siblings were engineers or technologists. My father's best friend was an astronautical engineer. Our next door neighbor was a physics professor. There were mathematicians at our church, sonic booms experts in my mother's sorority, and electrical engineers in my parents' college alumni associations. There were also black English professors, like my mother, as well as black doctors and dentists, black mechanics, janitors and contractors, black shoe repair owners, wedding planners, real estate agents, and undertakers, the occasional black lawyer, and a handful of black Mary Kay salespeople. As a child, however, I knew so many African Americans working in science, math, and engineering that I thought that just what black folk did." You see, Margaret Lee Shetterly was not raised up like the average black person in that she was raised in the NASA culture of those engineers. You see, she didn't grow up like most black folk. Now, the New York Times Book Review writes this about the book. Now, the book reviewer was Janae Levin. She writes, "Margaret Lee Shetterly does not play the austere historian in historical Hidden Figures. She is right there at the beginning with the evocative memories of her childhood, visiting her father, an engineer turned climate scientist at NASA's Langley Research Center in Virginia. Hidden Figures is clearly fueled by pride and admiration, a tender account of genuine transcendence and camaraderie. The story warmly conveys the dignity and refinement of these women. They defied barriers for privilege of offering their desperately needed technical abilities." You see, Margaret Lee Shetterly's book became what we have today, the movie Hidden Figures. Please understand that a movie and a screenplay is fiction based on a true story. In order that you can get a Buddhist or a cause and effect understanding, let us listen to the words of Margaret Lee Shetterly tell you about the book and the movie in her own words. Let's listen to the author of the book, Margaret Lee Shetterly. Now understand, she was born in 1969, and it was later on, just what, 2 years ago, that she wrote the book Hidden Figures, that is now a movie. Let's listen to Margaret Lee Shetterly.
My name is Margot Lee Shetterly. I'm the author of the book Hidden Figures, which tells a story, true story, this is not fiction, of the African-American women who worked as mathematicians starting in World War II and going through the space race. One of the women, in fact, the very first woman whose story I tell in the book is Dorothy Johnson Vaughan, who, in addition to being an amazing mathematician, had the distinction of being the very first black supervisor in the organization that became NASA. She was the head of the segregated West Computers Unit. She supervised a group, a room full of black female mathematicians, also brilliant women. And she nurtured the careers of so many people, including two of the other women that I write about in the book, Mary Jackson and Katherine Johnson, who is very well known for having calculated trajectories for the Mercury astronauts, and who last year received the Presidential Medal of Freedom. So while Mrs. Johnson's name has been known for some decades, Mrs. Vaughan's name was lost to history, and so finding her and finding about her has been one of the great privileges of my life. But one of the things that I had to realize is that a book and a movie are different vehicles, you know, and the kind of thing that people want out of a book and what they want out of 2 hours in a movie are very different. And so I didn't write the screenplay, but the screenwriters made what I thought was a good decision, which is they cannot tell 30 years of history and keep people interested in the movie. So they made the decision to focus on the iconic moment with Mrs. Johnson, where John Glenn is getting ready to go up into space, this orbital flight, which is a transformative moment in the Cold War between the U.S. and the Soviet Union. And he says, get the girl to do it. You know, get the girl, which is what they called all of the women, not just the black women. All of the women were girls. They were computers. Get the girl to check the numbers. And that's one of, you know, as one of his pre-flight checklists. If she says they're good, I'm good to go. That was Mrs. Johnson's big moment. It's, you know, it's a very exciting moment. It's a very cinematic moment. So, you know, I totally understand the decision to make that focus. I just hope that people will read the book because there are so many things that show the entire progression, you know, from these first women. So your grandmother showed up in December of 1943. And there were actually, you know, as best I can tell, about 15, 16 other women who were there. You know, the first women came that year, 1943. And they were really the ones who broke the ceiling for the other ones to follow. So, and then the end of the book, I focus on the story of Christine Johnson. She's the one who got to the top. She stood on all the shoulders of the women who came before, and she lived up to their promise and to her promise. So I am so excited about the movie because, you know, it means that this story is never going back into the shadows. But I hope people will read the book to get the fullness of all of these women. And, you know, one of the, I love your grandmother, what she stood for, what she did for all of these women, and what she has given to me, even though I never met her.
You heard the words of Margaret Lee Shatterley. Now, we explain to you that the Lotus Sutra teaches that there is a mutually inclusive relationship of all life and phenomena that is mutually inclusive. You see, we are explaining this from the standpoint of a Black Buddhist lecturer. Now, while she lived in Hampton, Virginia, and she was raised in a different environment, and she was not born until 1969, you know, which was, I was about 18 years old and 19 years old in 1969. Now, when you look at her life and you look at my life, it, even though there does not seem to be a mutually inclusive relationship, but we do have a relationship in that we are all connected karmically by the fact that we are black or African-American people. Now, I want you to refer to a book. Now, the book is by Edward E. Baptist, titled The Have Never Been Told, Slavery in the Making of Capitalism. You see, number one, slavery was the key driver of the formation of American wealth. Now, all told, more than 600 million, or almost half of the economic activity in the United States in 1836, derived directly or indirectly from cotton produced by the million odd slaves, 6% of the total U.S. population, who in that year toiled in labor camps on slavery's frontier. Number two, in its heyday, slavery was more efficient than free labor, contrary to the arguments made by some Northerners at the time. Number three, slavery didn't just enrich the South, but also drove the industrial boom in the North. And as enslaved hands made pounds of cotton more efficiently than free ones, dropping the inflation-adjusted price of cotton delivered to the U.S. and British textile mills by 60% between 1790 and 1860. The whipping machine was the freeing up millions of dollars for Boston Associates. Number four, slavery wasn't showing any signs of slowing down economically by the time of the Civil War came around. In the 1850s, Southern production of cotton doubled from 2 million to 4 million bales, with no sign of either slowing down or quenching the industrial West thirst for raw materials. The world's consumption of cotton grew from 1.5 billion to 2.5 billion pounds, and at the end of the decade, the hands of the U.S. fields were still picking two-thirds of it, and almost all that which went to Western Europe's factories. By 1860, the eight wealthiest states in the United States ranked by wealth, white person, were South Carolina, Mississippi, Louisiana, Georgia, Connecticut, Alabama, Florida, and Texas. Seven states created by the Cotton's March West and the South, plus one that, as the most industrialized state in the Union, profited disproportionately from the gearing of the Northern factory equipment to the Southwestern whipping machine. Number five, the South succeeded to guarantee the expansion of slavery, both the cotton capital or the world of the slave capital was right here in Memphis, Tennessee. We show a mutually inclusive relationship in slavery in the movie Hidden Figures. First, the ancestors to the women in the movie came from slavery. The ill treatment and the harsh policy of the black women came after slavery. Blacks were second-class citizens in America. There was no way the story of black women was about to be told in 1962. It was in 1964, whereas Dr. King got the Civil Rights Act of 1964 passed. Now, we explain that the Lotus Sutra teach there is a mutually inclusive relationship of all life and phenomena. This relationship encompasses the past, present, and future. Another way to explain this is Yoho Renge Kyo. If you wish to break this phenomena down, it is called Ho, or Law, or the 3,000 realms in a momentary state of existence. See, The Lotus Sutra break all phenomena down into 10 aspects. That is appearance, nature, entity, power, influence, inherent cause, relationship, latent effect, manifest effect, and the consistency from beginning to end. See, we explained to you that Margaret Lee Shetterly wrote the book Hidden Figures. A book and a movie are two distinct entities. However, they possess the 3,000 realms are broken down. We can explain it via the 10 aspects. Now, we explained to you that the book Hidden Figures, that in order for a book to manifest into a movie, there has to be a relationship as to how a book can manifest into a movie. There has to be a strong relationship. Now, let me give you a clear-cut example of a relationship as to how the influence of the book became the driving force to make the movie happen. Now, many of you have heard of the singer Pharrell Williams. See, Pharrell Williams is successful in that he has the money and the influence to get the movie produced. He has a relationship with this story. Now, let us listen to the words of the executive producer of the movie, Pharrell Williams. See, just like Pharrell Williams, who produced music, it is Pharrell Williams who produced the movie. You see, the movie just didn't happen because God made the movie happen. There was a series of cause and effect phenomena that tied everything in mystically, what we call Myoho from Tarara Henson, who is the main actor, to Pharrell Williams, to the writer and directors in the movie. Everything came together mystically like Myoho. Now, what I want you to do to get a Buddhist understanding, let me let you hear Pharrell Williams tell about his mystic relationship. Even, I don't know what kind of religion he's practiced, but you can tell he is a spiritual entity, and he understood that it was his destiny to help tell this story. And it all relates in a mutually inclusive relationship. Let's listen to Pharrell Williams, and we're going to come back and put a period on this lecture. Let's listen to him, and we're going to tie it back into Memphis, Tennessee, and we're going to bring this mutually inclusive relationship and tell you how Buddhism brings all of this together. Let's listen to Pharrell Williams.
Pharrell, it's always an honor, man. I consider you one of the artistic geniuses of my generation that I've been able to witness and watch, you know, and I love that you've taken it, you know, you and John Legend now have taken, like, your music, and now you're producing movies, and I'm glad y'all doing both, you know.
Thank you.
And more. I know this is an inspiring movie, it's a story, but did it being based in around Hampton, Virginia, in that area, did it have anything to do with you getting behind it?
100%. Hampton Roads, I'm like, man, I gotta be a part of this, you know? Three African-American women who are scientists, engineers, and mathematicians, gotta get behind that. Technologically advanced, gotta do it.
Yeah.
You know? Dealing with NASA and space, two subjects I was obsessed with since I was a child, gotta do it. Yeah. And, you know, it worked out. We're very grateful.
Yeah.
Sing it, Kim!
Hey! Now call it a mystery.
Line in the song Victory where you say I tallied all my losses and turned them into lessons.
Yeah.
And what I thought was less, turned it into blessings. Yeah. How do you apply that to your life? Like how did you take losses for you and turn them around into something greater?
Well, it's because Catherine, and you're asking me about me, right?
Yeah.
But I feel like that, you know, this was like about what she was going through.
Okay.
You still want me to answer it that way?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So, you know, what seemed to be less, she turned them into blessings. You know, it was actually what would seem like motivated her, but it turned into blessings because it never really got in the way of what her real MO was, what her real modus operandi was, which was to let the numbers work for themselves. You know, nothing got in the way. It was unobstructed. She had an unobstructed focus for like what the numbers mean, what they could do, and what they were going to do at that time.
With John Glenn, another huge pioneer for the world, passing yesterday, and him being brought to the screen in this movie, do you think like the timing of this movie and the story is something that will lead to a next generation of astronauts and space explorers and scientists? And
we're hoping that. We're hoping that there's a lot of women. We're hoping that a lot of young women see this and recognize that they have a place in science, technology, engineering, mathematics, you know? They have a place there in STEM.
How do you approach the music for this differently than Despicable Me or something like, how does that change for you as a composer, as a producer, when the storyline is changing? How does that, do you approach it differently at all when you're creating?
You do, for sure. I mean, I knew that I needed to behave like how a lot of the soul singers did during those days. It's like there was a lot of barriers and real tangible material life. So the music that they made needed to seem like it was coming from somewhere real feral and beautiful. And so the irony is that toward the end of 2014, I started working on this 1960s music, didn't really know why. I even put out a song, Freedom, in 15. And then right after that, we got the gig, and I was like, oh, okay, the universe is warming me up for this one. And that's when I wrote Running, and I wrote this other song called I See a Victory.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great music, man. Great stuff from you always.
We showed you how writer, producer Pharrell Williams tied in the mutually inclusive relationship into phenomena, in that he had a relationship and that he was from that part of Virginia. He talked to Catherine Johnson. His heart and soul was into this because he was the producer of the movie. He wanted part of this because he understood. Now, understand this. You heard him talk about the relationship of 60s music and its influence. He wrote music for the movie that reflect 60s music. Now, we told you that there's a mutual relationship of life and phenomena. Now, if it was not for Memphis, Tennessee, there would not be a Pharrell Williams. You see, Memphis was the slave capital of the world. Now, the father, after the Civil War, they set up the largest auditorium in Memphis, Tennessee, right here in Beale Street. And the father of the blues music came from right here in Memphis, W.C. Handy. Now, another thing happened in 1960. Now, rock and roll was born here. Blues, jazz, soul, and rock and roll was born here in Memphis, Tennessee. If it was not for the Memphis influence, you would not have a Pharrell Williams. So there's a mutually inclusive relationship. Now, in 1960, a friend of mine, in fact, she was at my house a couple of years ago. Her name is Carla Thomas. Carla Thomas and her father recorded a song called Cause I Love You. And because they recorded this hit song, see, her dad, Rufus Thomas, was born in about 1912, and she was just in high school, and she recorded the song with her daddy, and it was the first hit song in a little recording studio in Memphis called Stax Records. Now, what happened was, from Stax Records, a new culture was born called R&B. Memphis, Tennessee became the soul capital of the world. You know, Motown had their thing, you know, the smooth Motown sound, and then you had the Philadelphia sound, but the raw soul, that soul came from Memphis, Tennessee, from Stax. It started with Rufus and Carla Thomas. And what was produced or what happened in Memphis was the Memphis sound, the soul sound. I want you to listen to the story of Stax Records and tell how it mutually connects together. Let's listen to the story of Stax and how it ties into Pharrell Williams, because if it wasn't the Stax, that never would have been a Pharrell Williams, because some of the music of the 60s never would have came about to have a singer like Pharrell Williams or John Legend, who's out producing movies. They would not have been able to come. So there's a mutual inclusive relationship. Let's listen to the Stax story, and we're going to come back and put a closure on this lecture. Let's listen to the Stax.
The whole evolution of Stax was a parallel to what was happening in the civil rights movement.
We were an upstart company that had the audacity to be integrated.
We weren't in there doing things to prove that we were black and they were trying to prove they were white. We were in there proving that music is a sentiment of a man's soul.
We were doing the kind of music that was unheard of. It was a combination of gospel and blues and country.
And it's raw, gritty, gutsy soul. We had hit records. it was like great apples falling off a tree.
It changed everybody's perception of themselves. None of us had ever been paid that much attention.
Otis became that power pack, raw, gutsy, emotional, serious performer. I mean, you felt him, you heard the tear in his voice.
I've been loving you.
He said, well, they're all gone. I said, what do you mean gone? He said, they're gone. They all went in the lake of Wisconsin.
And I hollered to them, call an ambulance on your police radio. They said, where did the shot come from? So that's where the picture comes, with us pointing to the building across the street.
Now, after Dr. King was killed, it got pretty intense around there.
They lost their families. One person committed suicide.
But sometimes growth and ambition can wreck a company.
Dr. King had been killed, and we needed some sense of joy, some sense of strength.
It was just sad. It was like a family member had passed away.
Where you had freedom, you had harmony, you had people working together and not making a difference between each other.
We were trying to do the right thing, that we were concerned with civil rights, and we're taking an active role to show that.
that Stax thing was the greatest thing that ever happened to anybody that worked at Stax.
Once you're part of the music, it's till you die.
Saw the story about Stax. Now, let me kind of interrelate how Stax is tied in to Pharrell Williams in Memphis, Tennessee. You see, Stax Recording Studio was a powerhouse, and they were producing music that influenced not only Memphis, but the music of Memphis, Tennessee helped to change things in the world. And you had black people becoming multi-millionaires. They had a chance to make billions of dollars and influence the world. Now, this is actually what happened to Stax Recording Studio. Just, I want to show you a picture. If you look at just down the street, on my same street where I live from this house, I had a store at the railroad tracks, and I was on the south side of the railroad tracks of Southern Avenue. Now, on the other side of the tracks, there's a country club in a neighborhood called Chickasaw Gardens. Now, Chickasaw Garden is where the rich white folk live at. And Isaac Hayes, back in the 1960s, made so many millions of dollars, and he tried to buy a house in Chickasaw Gardens, and them white folk got together and said, we gonna stop these niggas. And they turned around, it was a bank called Union Planters. That means it was the bank of the cotton planters. And Union Planters got together, and they worked out a deal to destroy Stax Records. And they did. They said in Memphis they could not have no niggas making this kind of money, and they put a stop to Stax Records. This actually what happened. See, one of the things that happened, you see, in 1972, Stax got together, they had enough money in Los Angeles that in 1962, they made a movie called White Stax to commemorate the riots that happened in 1965. And they put on this thing called White Stax to bring some culture and pride to our people. And them white folk got so mad that you talking about some niggas having this kind of power? They broke Stax down. People went bankrupt. See, what they did was they loaned these brothers a lot of money and they borrowed on the advance. And then when it come time to pay or before the records can get out, they called the loans due and they had the money, and the brothers had went out and bought cars and all this kind of stuff. Even though they had potential to make millions of dollars, the bank closed the loan and they apprehended all the assets of Stax. Isaac Hayes, who was a Grammy and an Emmy Award winner of the movie Shaft, Isaac Hayes left Memphis, Tennessee in shame. He was so embarrassed being broke that he had to leave Memphis, Tennessee. In fact, in 1982, when I fought for the World Karate Kickboxing Championship, I personally went to Atlanta, Georgia, and I sought out Isaac Hayes, and I asked Isaac, I said, Isaac, please come to my fight. I'm fighting for a world title, and I'll be honored if you come and sing the national anthem. And on May the 29th, 1982, when I won the world karate kickboxing title, Isaac Hayes came to Memphis, Tennessee to support his homeboy, Anthony M. Elmore. Isaac came to support me. Now, this is what we have to understand. They closed Stacks for 2 decades, and an anonymous donor gave probably $5 million, and they made Stacks into a museum. While Stacks did not make it, they pioneered the way for black producers like Pharrell Williams, who was the producer of the movie Hidden Figures. Pharrell Williams can reference the 1960s music because Stacks music and other R&B music and musicians paved the way for entertainers like Pharrell Williams. It is the Lotus Sutra of true Buddhist teachings that show us the past, the present, and the future exist in a single momentary state of existence. Let me cite an example. At the time of this lecture, it is MLK Day in America. President-elect Donald Trump won an election on the promise to make America great again. The time he is referencing of making America great is the time of white supremacy, whereas in 1962, where the movie Hidden Figures take place, black people in America lived in a racist, segregated, unfair America. Although mathematician Katherine Johnson was a prodigy, and the reason why America is a great nation, blacks were discriminated against. This is not something that I made up, but PBS host Bill Morris just wrote on Saturday, the 14th of January 2017. He writes, Hidden Figures, what Trump's Attorney General pick Jeff Sessions want to keep in shadows. It was men like John Lewis who fought for stories, so stories like Hidden Figures can be told in America. In the picture shown, this is me and my wife with Congressman John Lewis. That is in a battle to this very day with the president-elect Donald Trump. The clear thing that we pointed out in this lecture, movie Hidden Figures, a Black Buddhist Lecture, is that true Buddhism has nothing to do exclusively with Asians, meditation, Japanese, or Asian culture. The Lotus Sutra equals our everyday life. Just as we look at the true title, Hidden Figures, I want you to refer to a news release published October the 19th, 2015, that I published. It's titled Buddha, the World's Greatest Black Hero, Robbery in Plain Daylight. The story reads, Shakyamuni Buddha is the world's greatest black hero whose black historical legacy was stolen in plain daylight by racist Brahmins in India, who are the fathers of the world's racism. Proud Black Buddhist World Association founder Anthony F. Elmore, Memphis, Tennessee, launching movement to fight for the Buddha's true legacy, fighting Buddhism's racism, unquote. See, the movie Hidden Figures is the number one movie in America. This movie is not just a black movie, but this movie is an American movie. This movie shows the greatness of America and that there are white people who want an America of inclusion of all people, given a fair share. The way Buddhism is taught in America, where it's all black history, culture, and language has been extricated from the Buddhist teachings. This is not the spirit of the Buddha Shakyamuni. Archaeology, anthropology, genetic science, literary science shows that the Buddha was not only black, but Buddhism is practice and the understanding of Namo Myoho Renge Kyo. This means giving reverence to the omnipresence, absolute, singularly law of cause and effect teachings. The calls that we make result in effects. If we want to advance as a society or humanity, we must make the right causes. Making the right causes is the essence of the Lotus Sutra. Dr. Martin Luther King had a great quote in reference to this Buddhist lecture. Dr. King said, quote, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice," unquote. In common sense terms, what goes around comes around, or is the law of cause and effect, which is what the Lotus Sutra teaches as the ultimate law of our universe. The correct religion to follow is that of the Lotus Sutra, which gives us a comprehensive understanding of the law of cause and effect. The arc or curve of the universe is long, as Dr. King noted. However, it bends toward justice. In the case of Mrs. Katherine Johnson, from the standpoint of Buddhism, we can say the Buddhist wisdom or God's mercy gave us Katherine Johnson when we Black people need her the most. We are so excited to learn that it was a Black woman who mapped out the mathematical trajectory to get the first American in space. Now, see, Miss Katherine Johnson dealt with mathematics and science. Please understand that the essence of the Lotus Sutra is mathematics and science. This is the meaning of Kyo, or the Buddhist teachings. Now, Namo means to awaken. It is Katherine Johnson, a Black woman, who is not only awakening Black people to math and science, she is awakening our nation to the fact not only can women do math, it was a Black woman who mapped the trajectory that got the first American to the moon. Now, there is more to this story. The arc of the moral universe that bends toward justice. Today, at the time of this lecture, we in America have the 45th president, Donald J. Trump. Now, Donald J. Trump won his election on bigotry, on rousing or bringing up the hate and the worst in other people who were discriminated against Black people, as in Katherine Johnson. This was the kind of America that Trump talks about to make America great again, that was not inclusive of all people. Now, Katherine Johnson today, she's 98 years old, and she let the math do the talking. Although whites are on record of discriminating against her and other Blacks, the arc of the moral universe gave Katherine Johnson justice. She lived not only to see America's first Black president, she received the Presidential Medal of Honor from President Obama. Please understand that we have what is called individual karma, and we have collective karma that works just as accurately as the math of Mrs. Katherine Johnson. See, while in 1962, she was discriminated against, please note that Katherine Johnson was born on August 26, 1918, when Woodrow Wilson was the president of the United States of America. Now, when Katherine Johnson was born, under Woodrow Wilson, it was Woodrow Wilson who first premiered the movie Birth of a Nation, or the birth of the Klansman. Woodrow Wilson was a Klansman. He supported the Klansman. He showed the movie Birth of a Nation at the White House, and he really discriminated against black people. So imagine now that it is Katherine Johnson who is in a movie, not like The Birth of a Nation, but she is a woman who is a model, not only as a African-American or as a black woman, but she is a model for women worldwide because of what she did in mathematics and science. Even today, we have in America one of the largest women movements and marches protesting the bigotry and the racism and the white supremacy and all of the negative things that President Trump has promoted to become the president. Well, this movie, Hidden Figures, there's an interrelated relationship of the women's movement and Katherine Johnson, because Katherine Johnson is a hero. So we see the arc of the moral, the arc of the covenant, or the arc of the arc of the curve of the universe has brought a sense of moral justice. We see this. So those of us who practice the Lotus Sutra, we must understand and have faith in the Lotus Sutra that even though the arc or the way the universe curves, but by doing the right thing and making right causes, you are going to get the right effects. It doesn't matter what someone else does. When you make the right calls, you get the right effects. That is what the Lotus Sutra is about. Anyway, let's bring this lecture to a close. It was 9 years after Katherine Johnson was hired that John Glenn was in the moment. You see, she was hired at NASA in 1953 when Dwight D. Eisenhower was president. And 9 years after John Glenn went into space in 1962, she was hired in 1953. Now, the true aspect of the Gohanzan, again, the Gosho reads, or the Lotus Sutra reads, the true aspect of all phenomena can only be understood and shared between Buddhas. This reality consists of the appearance, the nature, the entity, and it goes on with the power, the influence, the inherent cause, the relationship, the latent effect, manifest effect, and the consistency from beginning to the end. And that is Ho of Myoho or the Mystic Law. Now, today, Katherine Johnson is 98 years old, and she's a hero to not only black people. Katherine Johnson's a hero for women's rights worldwide. Her story is not just a movie, but her story is a movement. And the question is being asked, why are so many people crowdfunding Hidden Figures? You see, all over the world, all of America rather, people are buying out theaters. They got students to see this movie, Hidden Figures, because this is an inspirational movie. It is a movie about a black woman, but she is getting her justice. You see, so the law of cause and effect is working. Anyway, let me close this lecture with a quote from Forbes magazine that wrote about the movie, and the writer was Harry Rubenstein, who writes, "Why You Should Watch Hidden Figures." And he writes, quote, "Hidden Figures is a rare sit-up and lean-in crowd pleaser that isn't based on sports. You will cheer for these women while feeling guilty for the oversight of our past. You will hold your breath for the countdowns, though you know their outcome. Baby boomers walk out of the theater regularly, the duck and cover moments of their childhood." He says, look it up, millennials. "But most notably of all, on the red tie letter day is Hidden Figures. It is an obvious but indisputably effective reminder of the glory that is possible and how far we can go when Americans speak as we instead of me." just as the story of Katherine Johnson was hidden, they hid the story of the Black Buddha. And one day, this story too will come out and we will tell the story. Anyway, on this lecture, for the period on this lecture, I am Anthony Elmore, president of the Proud Black Buddhist World Association, bringing to you a Black Buddhist lecture called Movie Hidden Figures, a Black Buddhist Lecture. Thank you very much. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. I pray the Lord I'll suit your way. I pray every day to do my best, to practice peace and love and respect. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. I pray the Lord will suit your way. Devotion to the mystic law and cause and effect. Teaching, I believe, and wisdom reaching. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. I pray the Lord will suit your way. The Lord will suit you. Makes a lot of sense. It's about self-development and enlightenment. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. I pray the Lord will suit your way. The way that I pray, overcome my sins. I say the Lord's title again and again. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. I pray the Lord will suit your way. The Lord of Sutra has the test. The Lord of Sutra brings me happiness. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. I pray the Lord of Sutra way. Falling in the Lord of Sutra, I start to sing. I sing so loud, I start to scream. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. And I pray the Lord will suit your way. I don't pray like my Eastern brother. I pray and sing with my own culture. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. And I pray, Lord, to suit your way. I pray the way that I feel. I pray the black way and I start to squeal. Get down on my knees and I pray every day. And I pray, Lord, to suit your way. There's one thing you must know about me. I get like the church folk and I get happy. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. And I pray, Lord, to suit your way. I get down on my knees and I pray every day. And I pray, and I pray, I pray. I pray.
Knock your ring gate door, it's the way to make your karma go. Knock your ring gate door, it's the way to make your karma go. Knock your ring gate door, it's the way to make your karma go.